I ask the question, which one came first? Is it the chicken or the egg? And now please understand, I did not come to split the campus. So we may have different opinions, but I hope that we'll be able to come to a conclusion. So how many people think the egg came first? Because if there was no egg, there probably would be no chicken, I mean? Yes. Oxford, but somebody said, what was it that laid the egg? So the question really comes back to the same thing. Was it the chicken that came first, or was it the egg that came first? Okay, just because I do not want to cause any trouble in the house, permit me to say that whichever one you think is probably right. Because you can be justified, but if you draw from the book of creation, and at the foundation of creation, we do not have it on record that God ever made eggs. What we have it on record is that God made chickens and gave chickens the capacity, the ability to reproduce according to their own kind. And in the process of reproduction, the chicken was able to deliver the egg. But because in every fruit, there is also the seed that produced the fruits, you will find that in every egg, there is a chicken in it. So, the whole concept of chicken and eggs fits to a vicious cycle. And that vicious cycle I want to apply to the concept of great institutions and great students and alumni. And I'll ask the question, so which one comes first? Is it a great school that produces great alumni, or is it the greatness of the alumni that validates that the school is great? Because clearly, in my opinion, I want to give you a few examples that might help us to draw down to a conclusion. On Thursday, I had one of the greatest accomplishments of my own life when I had the opportunity to become a lecturer at the prestigious Stanford University, having teaching ethical leadership on their seed program. Now, you may need to understand this. I talked about the chicken and the egg. You see, my parents were both professors. My father was a professor of physiology, and he became the youngest professor in Nigeria in 1975 at the age of 36. My mother became the only professor of quaternary geology and the only female professor of quaternary geology in Africa. So you see, the apple doesn't really fall far from the tree. Whilst my parents were lecturers and teachers, today their son has also become a professor of a very prestigious university in the United States of America. Before I go on, I challenge you to think about what I have just told you. Because my question is, if your children were to choose to walk in the path that you are walking today, will they be proud and glad that one day what they have become is what it was that you made for them? And this is a Sela moment. It's something that you think, but there will be no answer. But permit me to quickly talk to you about now becoming my university, the Stanford University. I want to tell you something that happened, that the program in which I went to speak and teach on ethical leadership is a program that was funded by a couple. Robert and Dr. King. And Robert and Dr. King gave, for the establishment of that program, $100 million cash to Stanford University, and they made a pledge of $50 million in matching funds, meaning that for every $1 that Stanford was able to raise, up to the tune of $50 million, Robert and Dr. King were able to match so that their collective giving to the development of entrepreneurship in developing countries was $150 million. One couple, husband husband and wife. Hmm. And if they walk into this place today, you probably may not even rise to top of them. Hmm. They are one of the most simplest people that you can ever meet. $150 million given to one university. That was not their first gift. This was just towards one program. Over the last 50 years, Stanford University has created through its alumni 18,000 companies. And of the companies that Stanford University created that do business in California, the state of California in the United States, those businesses contributed, that is Stanford and online businesses, contributed $1.27 trillion to the economy of the state of California in 1 year, 2016. So this was the contribution of not all the alumni of Stanford, only the ones in California. In fact, one of the things I will show you is that when you think about it, 1.2 trillion is the same thing as 1,270 billion. This was what just a few alumni contributed to the state of California. Now, when you compare that to the 400 billion, which is the Nigerian GDP, meaning the collective contribution of every Nigerian in the year 2016, the alumni of Stanford created three times the value of all the people of Nigeria put together in 1 year. And that's not all. They only did that in one state in America. Stanford professors between the year 1930 and 2012 have created ideas that have been patented and worth $2.7 trillion. When you compare that, that will be 972 trillion naira that Stanford University professors alone have contributed to the economy. Of the alumni and the lecturers, or is it the Stanford that produces great alumni? I have here a lot of much more UPOR presidents in the United States than others. And when you look at it, you see that Harvard University once again tops the list, having produced 6 presidents for the United States of America and 4 vice presidents for the United States of America. And then you go all the way down, Yale has produced 3, Princeton has produced 2. Again, I'm challenging and hoping that not too long from now, University of Ilorin, the great, better by far university, will be able to produce the best presidents, governors, senators, chief executives, members of houses of state and assembly, state of assembly. I believe very strongly that greatness is tied to this school. Why? Because it is when schools produce great alumni that those great alumni also give back to the school. Let me be clear about something. It has been shown that most public schools that have more than $1 billion in cash or assets have up to 68, Vice Chancellor, I hope you're listening to this, sir, 68% of their assets were funded by the alumni. Means that when you look at that top 10 list, for any of them that have over $1 billion in assets, that means those assets are funded up to the tune of almost $700 million by their owner. This means that most great institutions do not have to rely on government subvention. So whether governments have to cut down on education or not, it's not the bother of a great university, because great universities are great alumni who appreciate that their university was not brought their greatness. And so they will go out there and use their funding to be able to support the university. It is a vicious cycle that must not be broken. The challenge, however, is that wherever those people are, listen to this, it has been said that wherever the heart is, the treasure goes. meaning that if the students of a campus are not happy with the experience they had on that campus, they can never put their money back into that campus. On the other hand, if the students of any campus have fond memories of their lecturers, of their lectures, of their accommodation, of their well-being and their lifestyle, they will very much make great money and bring that money back to be able to cover that cost so that other people coming behind them are able to do the same. So how does this lead to the topic of the day? Constructive unionism and an imperative for visionary leaders. I believe that because great institutions must of necessity produce visionary leaders will find a way to ensure the sustainability of that great institution. But we have found out something that is a great disruptor in most campuses, and that is something called destructive and disruptive unionism. We found out that on many campuses today, Nigerians do not want to send their children to Nigerian schools. They are willing to save up to 500, 600 naira per £1 or $360 to $1 to be able to send their children out of Nigeria, spending billions of naira. Let me quickly say that behind the petroleum industry, the greatest flight of cash and resources from Nigeria is Nigeria's education. And so the bottom line is that I want you to understand that the challenge that we face before us today is how do we improve the quality of education of our students, especially at the tertiary level. Nigeria is a blessed country. Does anybody agree with me? That God has blessed this nation, but we have not yet seen the full manifestation of the blessing because there is something that is extremely important to understand. That the economy of any nation is the collective financial well-being of all the people in that nation. Now, listen to this. There is a very special relationship between two words, learn and earn. Meaning that the more the people are able to learn in any country, the greater their capacity to learn, to earn. So therefore, we have found out that if students do not go beyond primary school, the capacity for them to earn more than 25,000 naira after 5 years of work is very little. But if they go all the way to secondary school and they drop out, even after 5 years, they might be able to earn up to only 50,000 naira per month. If they go all the way to university, we are found by studies that the amount that they are able to earn is going to rise to about 100,000. Meaning after 5 years of working hard, the chances are that a graduate will be able to earn possibly 100,000. And if they go all the way to master's level, then it increases their capacity to earn to about 155,000. This is what the research shows. So this means that any country that does not invest in the education of its people is already bankrupting its own economy. President Bill Clinton came to Nigeria in August 2001 and he spoke to the joint house of the Senate and House of Representatives, and he said something in his address. He said in the 21st century, the wealth of nations will not be calibrated by what lies under the feet of its people. The wealth of nations will be calibrated by what lies within the ears, in between the ears of its people. And was saying, therefore, that mineral resources are not the greatest sector of any nature, but education was the greatest sector. He went on to show that a country like Japan, which is literally a tiny ocean in the Pacific Island, Japan does not have enough steel to produce the bonnet of a car. Japan does not have enough rubber to produce the steering wheel of a car. Japan does not have enough silicone to produce a side mirror, speak less of a windscreen. And yet, Japan is one of the largest exporters of automobiles all over the world. How can a nation that does not have any mineral resources of economically valuable quantity being the third largest economy in the world, behind China and the United States. Well, the secret may lie in a statement that was made by the Prime Minister of Japan in 2006 at the anniversary of the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombing. And he said, should it ever happen to Japan again, that such a mishap like the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombing should ever happen again, if any country wanting to bomb Japan can only give them 6 months' notice, they will move all the people of Japan out and put them in the desert, and within 7 years, they will recreate the Japanese economy. Meaning that the economy of Japan is not under the feet of Japan. The economy of Japan is between its ears. So I want you to understand that you are sitting down in the economic generator of the future. Institutions like University of Ilorin need to be supported with everything that we can have, whilst we can, because there's coming a point in time when we grow older that we will not have the opportunity and the strength to be able to do the things we wanted to do when we were much younger. So I challenge each and every one of you to invest in education. But what is the thing that has caused most people to not want to send their children to Nigeria? Simply, student union activities. Most universities across Nigeria, you will agree with me, do not have constructive unionism. They have destructive unionism. They have a situation where most of their student unions have an anuta, struggle, continues, fight till we finish mentality. And because they have an anuta mentality, everything they see, they interpret as battle. Now, is it wrong for you to fight for your rights? Absolutely not. The only problem is when you have a paradigm that states that everything must be a struggle. I want you to understand that practice makes perfect. And if you struggle and practice the art of struggling, by the time you grow up, you will even be struggling with your own staff. You will struggle with your wife. You will struggle with your children. You will struggle because everything that you have perfected is the act of struggle. There is a difference that divisive critical unionism can bring, and it is to break down peace, progress on that campus, and most importantly, to be able to cause that most people will not want to send their children to those schools. What divisive unionism may not recognize is that the quality of the education that we have is going to determine the quality of the graduates that we produce. And the quality of the graduates that we produce will determine the quality of the well-being and the economic well-being of those graduates and their ability to give back to schools. So on campuses that have divisive unionism, they scatter the school. Parents don't want to send their brightest children to those schools. Therefore, the quality of the students that come to the school is low. The quality of education they get out of the school is low. The quality of graduates that come out of the school is low. And therefore, most importantly, the quality of the graduates and their well-being is low. So they cannot even give back to the school. So divisive unionism, destructive unionism, only destroys the well-being of a campus over time. What is the option? Constructive unionism. Ronald Perelman, General Archer Chan, paid $350 million to Harvard School of Public Health. They were both graduates and union leaders in that school. The family of the Zings gave over $150 million. Why? Again, because they were involved with the student union management, and then they came back and they built an institution that built them. Whenever you have constructive unionism, you will have a collaboration between all the stakeholders of the university. You will be able to come up with constructive ideas that solve problems. But most importantly, because the quality of student union governance usually shows up in a few years in the quality of public government, we have found out that those who will soon become great leaders in the country. So, I begin to bring my thoughts to a close to say, many times when students begin to think that as long as I can do what I want to do and get out and finish my own education and go my own way, it doesn't matter whether the school is doing well, it doesn't matter whether the students have accommodation, it doesn't matter whether they are feeding or faring well. After some time, as you know, if you look at this particular script, it says, I'm sure glad the world is not at our end. But the question I'm here to ask you is, does it matter whose end the hole is at? Sorry. If there is a hole in the boat, what's going to happen to the whole boat? So I want you to remember that, listen, individual success in the midst of collective failure will always lead to collective failure. One rich person in the midst of 9 poor people will always lead to a collection of 10 poor people. Remember that even if we are able to produce people who are able to buy jeeps, but they don't care about the roads that they tread on, that will not be a great leader. That it will not be greatness for you to be able to inherit public stable power, and next, the only thing you can give to the next generation is generators. That it is not going to be wise for you to inherit quality education and knock out education from the schools that you are going to bestow to the next generation. It is in our own best interest that all of us are able to do great things because we are all members of this thing that I call the human race. And the human race is a race where one generation must run their race and hand over to the next generation. And that next generation must be able to run their race in a way that will transfer an advantage to the next generation. A great generation is the one that makes things better for the next generation. A wasted generation is the one that makes things worse. Professor Wale Soyinka once said concerning his own generation, this is not me saying it, he was the one that said it at his 70th birthday, and he said his was a wasted generation. And when people came to say to him, how can you say that your generation is wasted? Don't you know you have a loud voice? Professor Wale Soyinka responded, there comes a point in time in everybody's life where you can no longer afford the luxury of self-deceit. Wale Soyinka said, one day, you will look at yourself without needing a mirror. And he said, a wasted generation is a generation that hands over a disadvantage to the next generation. Said, a wasted generation knocks out water from its taps, knocks out light from its bulbs, knocks out health from schools, knocks out education, health from hospitals, and education from schools. A wasted generation is a generation that goes through a school but does not want its children to go through that school. A wasted generation knocks out value from its currency and knocks out value from its children. I challenge every university, especially the University of Ilorin, to raise great leaders who will hand over an advantage to the next generation. I bring my thoughts to a close by saying, in the words of Nelson Mandela, sometimes it falls upon a generation to be great. He says, you can be that great generation, but you must let your greatness blossom. And what Nelson Mandela was saying to each and every one of us is that we can be that great generation, not because we choose to be great, but because greatness has chosen us. I believe that this is the generation that will bring forth the reality of Nigeria's ability. We know that Nigeria is blessed. And I believe very strongly that by December 31, 2025, a great generation is emerging from Nigeria. A generation that is poised, not as a Hausa or Fulani or Yoruba or Igbo or Igbo or Kwakure or Kwara. A generation that does not count its state before its nation, but a generation that says we are united as one people. And that every girl in this country, every single workplace must be safe for all. Fellow must be safe for all Nigerians, not just people from Kano State. Kwara must be safe for all people of Nigeria, not just the people of Kwara State. Lagos must be safe for all people of Lagos, not just the people of Lagos State. I believe there is coming a point in time, not long in the future, a new Nigeria is emerging where your state of origin is not what we are going to ask you, but it is your state of residence and your state of origin. Nigeria, and it will not be longer than 8 years. Now you will ask me, how can these things be? Well, we have seen it all over the world. We have seen Dubai transform in 13 years. We have seen Shanghai transform in 20 years. We have seen each and every one of these countries. What it takes is a generation that decides to be empowered. A generation that will be guided by values and virtue. A generation that will not look to leadership as a position of authority, but will understand that leadership is a mindset of ownership, of accountability and responsibility, not only to its own generation, but to the current generation. Leadership is the ability to deliver the future of a country. The future is not a time zone that is yet to come. The future is everything we can be as a people but have not yet become. The future is everything we can do as a people but have not yet done. The future is everything we can have as a people but have not possessed. The future of Nigeria is not ahead of us. The future of Nigeria is inside of us. That is why the challenge that is there for our generation is to deliver the future. And through constructive unionism, that great vision of building a new nation, a nation that is better than the one that we live in, a nation that we will be proud to hand over to our children and they will be grateful to receive from us, that is what makes visionary leaders. And those are the kind of people that we need in students' union all across. So what is the role of students? You must find those people amongst yourself. You must make sure that never again will any kind of belittled, berated people who have no mind but to bring about destruction ever, ever show up in your students' union ever again. I challenge all the students to ensure that you identify the brightest and the best amongst you who have the capacity to take the best decisions on your behalf. Who have the capacity to be able to negotiate with the university authorities without fighting them. I challenge you to be able to not only identify those people, but encourage them to go forth. Because many times the brightest and best people will not go forth until they are pushed. But don't only do that, empower them, encourage them, volunteer for them, and make sure that the brightest and best people do. And as you do that, I want you to remember that the same thing you have to do across our political system. We need a country that will deliver good governance for Nigeria. And good governance in Nigeria is going to come when two things happen. Number one, good governance is going to happen when we take politics out of government. And the second thing is when we put democracy into our political parties. So that nobody can select anybody who will be chairman of the local government, but it will be the people of the local government that will want to vote for who their candidate will be and who we think that they will elect. A new Nigeria is coming, and I tell you all that coming soon. And the people who are here in this Nigeria will see it. I believe and I pray that none of you will pass on before 2025.